सो गुड आफ्टरनून टू एवरीवन। सेकंड सेशन ऑफ डे टू, ओके सेकंड सेशन ऑफ डे टू। प्रीवियसली इट वाज द सेकंड लेक्चर ऑफ प्रोफेसर इंटू बनर्जी मैम, बट ड्यू टू सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम्स और सम इश्यूज वी हैव शिफ्टेड टॉक फ्रॉम प्रोफेसर बनर्जी टू डॉक्टर सुनील कुमार एंड positively we will have the second lecture of professor banerjee in this time span of 5 days of fdp. Let us look after that with this after discussion with professor banerjee. So let me introduce dr sunil kumar before starting the session. Dr sunil kumar has completed his btech in mechanical engineering from kurukshetra university, mtech in mechanical engineering. Tech in mechanical engineering from PEC University of Technology Chandigarh and PhD pursuing in the field of renewable energy biofuels from UTU Dehradun. He has 10 years of teaching experience in the field of mechanical and energy engineering and taught various subjects. Currently he is working as an assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering and Technology, Gurukul Kangri Vishwavidyalaya, Haridwar. His area of interest is biodiesel production methodology, enhancement in fuel properties and application of biofuel on engine operations. He has published more than 16 papers in various international journals and conferences. He got 10 papers in SCI and Scopus Index journal. He is an active member of the Indian Science Congress Association India. He also served as reviewer of Materials Today Proceedings, Energy Source Part A and Energy Journal. Recently he has published his patent on foldable bridge assembly. He presented the paper more than 14 national and international conferences. So the topic for today's talk of Dr. Sunil Kumar is fuel to biofuels. Dr. Sunil, I welcome you on the behalf of Gurukul Kangri Vishwavidyalaya in this second session of day 3 in the ATAL FDP on alternate fuels, biofuels. So the session is over to you, Sunil sir. Please share your deliberations with us, Dr. Sunil sir.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for such a wonderful introduction, Dr. Sun. I would like to say first of all, before start my session, thank you to Gurukul Kangri University, Faculty of Engineering and Technology, and Dean of Faculty of Engineering and Technology, Dr. Madan sir, and Dr. Lamba sir, and all the colleagues of Faculty of Engineering and Technology to give me such opportunity to present my view on this platform. And now I'm going to start my session. Now here is my introduction slide. Let me share first. I think I am visible to all and also audible. So here is my first slide. And the topic is fuel to biofuel. And here is my simple introduction. Sunil Kumar Sharma, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Gurukul Kangri Vishwavidyalaya, Haridwar. Let's start. We start the session from this FDP sessions from 21st September. And starting with the most renowned personality, Dr. Siddharth Jain, then after Dr. Gaurav Dwivedi, and yesterday's session was starting with the stress management and number of talks on biofuels. I think there is nobody introduce basics of fuels. That is the initiate from where our topic starts. And here is, now I'm going to first, let me introduce my content and starting with the biofuels. Starting biofuels introductions and types of biofuels, and there are number of biofuels, but we discuss in our session only that is related to our topic, alternate fuel biofuels. And second, after that, introduction of fuel and its types, their types, and there may be some videos if possible. There may be, if there is no technical or some network problem, and then we will move towards alternate fuel, so means substitutes of conventional fuels, and we will discuss different type of alternate fuels, and after that practical implementations from academic or researcher point of view, or we are in the field, that is teaching. So DOE is most important, how we conduct the experiment, how we run the experiment, and what is our output on latest technology with different softwares, that we will discuss in later info at fourth term. Then after that, there is biodiesel production and optimizations, that I works on a but already published paper, and at the end I give some detail of my publications that in a reputed or SCI journals. Now let's start with the basic definition of biofuels. So here is, I think, visible to all, my first slide. So here is the definition. Biofuel is basically solid, liquid, or gaseous fuel based on biological materials. Means biofuel, everything which is biological on this planet, we can convert that material into biofuels in different way or different process or different, with the help of different techniques. And there are normally two definitions come in the mind. There are two definitions. One is conventional fuel or non-renewable, and other is non-conventional or renewable. But if we see technically, everything is renewable and non-conventional. But the difference is only time. So here is definition. Biofuel derived from recently dead so there is particular word mentioned here, recently dead biological materials. Biofuels derived from recently dead biological, most commonly plant. Recently dead elements means 2-3 years or 5 or 10 years. And if the time span is more than 10 or 15 years, then it is not considered in the category of renewable. It is termed as a non-renewable. If we see basically the basic fuels like coal and woods, they are also renewable, but or petrochem or fossil fuels that is available in the oceans, all are renewable, but it takes 300 millions of years, or minimum I think 300 years it take times. So there is they do not fall in the category of renewable category, but technically if we see these are renewable. So here, that's why I mention in this statement, biofuel derived from recently dead biological material, most commonly plants. This distinguishes it from fossil fuels, which is derived from long dead biological materials. So here is the difference between little bit different. Technically, we can say the difference between renewable and non-renewable biofuels or biological materials. And here is the basic classification, or you can say types of biofuels. Biofuels are generally, there are number of categories, but I mentioned here what belong to our topic, that is biofuels. So biofuels, we deals with the ethanol, or you can say alcohol products, in bioethanol, biomethanol, or biobutanol. Then from Indian scenario, biodiesel is one of the hottest topic. And next is biogas. So Dr. In the previous session, Dr. Banerjee explained bioethanol in a very well manners and explained lots of things regarding ethanol productions, how ethanol produced from different crops available. And generally, ethanol or methanol, alcohol is produced the crops having starch or glucose type materials. And biobutanol is also another version of alcohol. And biogas, we all know, biogas is the nature, basically methane produced from different products, biomasses. Now there are number of biomasses. And next is biodiesel. Obviously, biodiesel, there are number of feedstocks available. If we go worldwide, according to literature view, there are more than 300 feedstocks only in plants that is used to produce biodiesels. And now we will discuss in detail this topic biodiesel later, in later slides. And here is the life cycle of biofuels, how one thing is converted into other, starting with the feedstocks. Here is feedstock developed in the different part of earth in the form of plants or vegetable oils or different feedstock form. Then these feedstocks transported to the refinery with the help of some means. There are different means of transportations. So feedstock is from there produced, transported to the particular place where it can be converted into desired product. So here is, then after transportation in biorefineries, they converted into alcohol, biodiesel, or in different biofuels. There are number of biofuels available now these days. And then processing and conversion take place. And after that, it is distributed from the different fuel stations. Then after this fuel station, this is goes to end user, where they convert, they utilize it in the different form. And there is also connection between feedstock and end user. The exhaust coming out from this end user in the form of CO2 is the diet, or you can say food for the feedstock product or plant for their productions. So there is cycle is complete from feedstock to end user, and then end user to again feedstock. This cycle continues from the on this planet Earth from the last few number of years. Now here is pros and cons of biodiesels, biofuels. First we discuss the pros, means advantages, or you can say benefit of the biodiesel. First one, biofuel is renewable. Obviously, as I already explained, what is the meaning of renewable, technically definition of renewable. Then reduce greenhouse gases means exhaust emissions. If we compared with the fossil fuel, then there are number of research and we have a number of literatures on that. There may be drastically up to if we go data, then maximum, I think 30% decrease in greenhouse gases, 30% reduction in emissions, exhaust emissions, gases. Then economic security. Obviously, economic fossil, today the price of petrol is near about in Uttarakhand is 82, and price of diesel engine is diesel is I think near about 72, and if we have alternate of this fossil fuel, then there may be we will be economically secure. And according to literature, if we go with the biofuels, biodiesels particularly, normally from today's scenario, we can get the biodiesel at the rate of 50 in Indian rupees. So there is much more difference between fossil fuel price and biofuel price. Then next is easy to source. Source is also locally available. Fossil, you all know that fossil fuels like petrol, diesel are available beneath the oceans, and we have to do lots of work to extract these fuels and then process it and then distribute it at the different places all over India. Still, we have such point number of points in all over India that there is no reach of this petrol or diesel now in 2020 also. So if we produce these locally with the local material that is found abundant in the local area, then we can convert this biofuel, these crops or whatever be the feedstocks or resource into fuels. And so it is cheaper or easy to source. Then next, lower level of pollution already discussed. Obviously, there is let me discuss, but there is little bit problem with the NOx emission only with biodiesel. Rather, other than that, all if we go for emissions particle like carbon monoxide, hydrocarbon, sulfur content, all are very less as compared to petrol or diesel. Then moving towards the disadvantages, or you can say cons, and industrial, first cons is industrial pollutions. Industrial pollutions means here conversion, just as I show in previous slides, feedstock is converted into biofuels in refineries. To convert this, there may be some process or technique is used. So to convert this feedstock into biofuels, with the help of these techniques, so we use electricity and other conventional source. So industrial pollution take place for conversion from this feedstock to biofuels. Then future rise in price. Future rise in price means that the cost of the basic product, the basic feedstock that we use to convert into biofuel is rise. For example, if we use edible oil, that is first generation oil, into biodiesel, then there is shortage of this edible oils for the humans. So the price may, obviously price, the game of supply and demand. So if there is more demand, then price also rise. This is maybe one of the cause, cons. Then next is shortage of food, obviously discussed. Then use of fertilizer. To produce all these feedstock naturally, we use number of fertilizers, and obviously we all know that use of fertilizers means indirectly we infertile the land or pollute our atmosphere. And now next, moving towards the next slide, here is fuels and its classification. Let's start with the fuels. Fuel is the material that is used to produce energy in different forms. So there are a number of definitions if we go with different theories, but technically fuel is the material that burns in the presence of oxygen and produce byproducts as well as heat or energy in large amount. That is called fuel. And now classification, obviously, basically there are two type of classification: primary, or you can say natural fuel, then secondary artificial fuel. We can say that this is secondary, but this artificial fuel also derived from this primary or natural fuels. So this is directly or indirectly is also a same as natural fuel, second version of natural fuel, just like we derived curd, or you can say whey, from the basic milk. So next classification is natural fuel. Obviously solids, liquid, these are the three, and gaseous. These are the three states of material. We all know everything in this world. There are three states only: solid, liquid, and gases. Obviously there may be intermediate state also, semi-solid, semi-liquid, and liquid and gaseous mixture state, but broadly there are three classifications: solid fuels, liquid fuels, and gaseous fuels. With the example, solid fuel example is wood, and liquid fuel example is oil, then natural gas. And similarly, artificial fuels also found in the three categories: solid fuels, liquid fuels, and gaseous fuels. And these categories are charcoal derived from coal, and liquid fuels, petrol, derived from naturally available oils, and gaseous fuels is second version of LPG, CNG, the example of which is the next to natural gases. Here is the requirement of good fuels, means what we expect from the fuel. So here is classification is, first one, high calorific value. Obviously there must be some calorific value, means amount of energy that produced by the fuels must be high. And second is moderate ignition temperature. The ignition temperature must be moderate. It not be too low or too high. If it is too low, then it will explode itself. No need to ignite it. And if it is too high, then we need a lot of effort to ignite it. Then next is low moisture content. Obviously, all the fuels have moisture in it. So which produce obstacle in burning. So the percentage of moisture or water content must be low. Then easy to transport and available at low cost. Obviously, we are in Indian, everything is, we think about, first we think about the cost and availability from Indian scenario. So this line definitely belong to us: easy to transport and readily available at low cost. Then combustion should be controllable. This is also important for fuel. Combustion must be controllable. If it not controllable, then explosion may take place and we can't utilize it, the fuels. Then it should be easy to store and handle. Obviously, storing must be there. If we can't store, then how we can use it in our desired manners? So here is the few units that we use directly or indirectly in the form of renewable energy. It may be either in electric form, or maybe in oil form, or maybe in solid form or liquid form, or there are different form of energies, from electricity to oil or some other. So first with femto, 10 raised to power minus 15. femtoseconds laser. This is the example in laser cutting from mechanical point of view. We use laser beam machining. We already studied in different chapters or different our curriculums that cutting with the help of this laser is goes up to femto, means 10 raised to power minus 15, then pico, 10 raised to power 12. There is a device in electronics. Pico ampere is current measured, very sophisticated instrument available in electronics lab. That pico is measured with this pico ampere meter to used for measuring the current. Then nano, obviously everyone know this is in 2020, everything is talk about nanotechnology. So what is nanotechnology? 10 raised to power 9 nanomaterials are used at different level in production, in manufacturing, in biomedical science. There are number of fields we use nanotechnology. And then micro, obviously 10 raised to power minus 6 is the unit in which we measure micro structures for materials. For normally we use scan electron micrography in research to study the micro level, or we can use microscope to study the microstructures. So 10 raised to power minus 6 is micro. Then milli, 10 raised to power minus 3 is millimeter. Obviously our scale we use in generally daily life, there is, and our SI unit is in millimeter or meter. Then kilo, 10 raised to power 3. Kilogram is generally we use in daily life, number of things available in kilograms. Even if we go for a biomass also available in, everything is measured in, normally energy also measured in megajoule or kilojoule divided by per kilogram. Then mega, 10 raised to power 6 megapixels is, we all know our mobile camera is in megapixels. Then gigabyte is 10 raised to power 9, means gigabyte available in RAM, computer RAMs. And terabyte is 10 raised to power 12. Terabyte hard disk is available, normally available. And there are number of storage devices having capacity of terabyte, means 10 raised to power 12. Then peta means 10 raised to power 15. Peta flops in supercomputers. This is also just kind of a RAM which we use in supercomputers. Then exa. This is the energy form we used in wide energy uses. 10 raised to power 18. Normally we use, or you can see in number of research paper or data, that world energy consumption is measured in exajoules. So that means the energy used in 10 raised to power 18 joules. Then next is zeta. Zeta is 10 raised to power 25. Then 7 zeta by data in 2020. Zettabyte also used in computers. And then yota. Yota is normally used to measure or traveling the light waves or distance between planet, between two planets. Then 10 raised to power 24 is yota units. One yota meter equal to, approximately equal to 100 million light year, used to measure traveling of distance between one planet to another planet on the galaxy. So here is the some scalars unit which we use scientifically. And now the units of energy. As I told, there are different form of energy. For example, if we produce electricity, electrical form, then it is in kilowatt hour. And these are the energy used in our biofuels terms or fuel terms, joules, calorie, and BTU means British thermal units. And here is the equivalence, that is conversion. We produce, for example, produce electricity, and that is used to convert in biofuels or any other form of energy. And here is the relations between the different form of energy. For example, if energy is in joule and we want to convert, then 1 joule equal to 0.2390 calorie, and then if we convert it into BTU, British thermal unit, then it is 0.000948, and in electrical form it is 2.777 into 10 raised to power minus 07 kilowatt hour. Then our energy is in the form of calorie, then it can be converted into joule in 4.187, and obviously calorie equal to calorie, 1 calorie equal to 1 calorie. Then if we convert it 1 calorie into BTU, then it is 0.0397. then conversion into kilowatt hours is 1.162 into 10 raised to power minus 06. Then here is BTU. BTU, 1 BTU equal to 1055 joules, and 1 BTU equal to 252 calorie, and 1 BTU equal to 0.000293 kilowatt hour, and 1 kilowatt hour equal to 3.6 into 10 raised to power 6 joules. And if we convert this kilowatt into calorie, then 1 kilowatt hour equal to 8.6 10 raised to power 5. Then BTU, 1 kilowatt hour equal to 3412 BTU. So here is the equivalence of the energy in one form to another form. So moving towards the next slides, here is the already discussed first point in this requirement, high calorific value needed. So here is the Dulong formula for calculation, somewhat relates to chemistry. Persons present in the this faculty development program, so there are two type of we measure calorific value, high calorific value and low calorific value. This gross calorific value also means same is high calorific value. There is the Dulong formula for calculation of gross calorific. 1 by 100 equal to multiplied by 8080. C is carbon, percentage of carbon, plus 34500 hydrogen atom, hydrogen present in the fuel, minus oxygen present in the fuel, divided by 8, then plus 2240 sulfur content. And this gross calorific value comes in the form of kilocalorie per kilogram. Then lower calorific value is high calorific value minus 9 by 100 multiplied by hydrogen present into 587 kilocalorie. This is how we calculate calorific value, the formula given by Dulong, one of the scientists. Then combustion. Here is a little bit about, as I already told, that consumption of fuels means fuel mixed with the burned in the presence of air, or you can say oxygen, exactly with the in the presence of oxygen. So here is the condition of combustion. Combustion is basically a process in which oxygen from the air react with the element or compound to give heat. This is the condition. Actually, if there is no intimate mixing of air with combustion or matter, then there may be no burning take place, or there may be no combustion take place, and then sufficient time to allow to the combustion process to complete. Sufficient time is also important. If there is no sufficient time, then incomplete combustion take place, or there may be no combustion take place. If these factors are inappropriate, inefficient combustion occur. The elements are usually present in the common fuel which enter into the process of combustion are carbon, hydrogen, sulfur and oxygen. These are the basic elements which we part of the chemistry point of view available in the form of carbon, hydrogen, sulfur and oxygen. Here is the basic or simple formula. This is the basic example, actually, to calculate the amount of oxygen for burning required for the burning. Basic net amount of oxygen required is measured. Total amount of oxygen required minus already oxygen present in the fuel. Here example, for example, carbon is burnt in the presence of oxygen from CO2. By weight, carbon atomic weight is 12 gram and oxygen is 32 and CO2 is 44. By volume, one element used and oxygen combinedly one element. O2, because oxygen always found in the O2 form, not in the form of single O. Then in the similar way, hydrogen burns in the presence of oxygen and convert into water. And by weight, hydrogen have 4 gram and oxygen have 32 grams and weight of the water is 36 gram. By volume is 212. Then calculation is like that. For example, carbon present in the 0.85% and hydrogen present in the 0.1%. And oxygen is present in the fuel 0.5 gram. Then how we find the amount of carbon requires amount of oxygen required to burn this carbon is 0.85, that is the percentage available in the fuel, multiply by this oxygen 32 divided by carbon atom, and output is 2.26 kilogram and hydrogen is only 8. 8 means divide this 32 by 4. 0.41 into 8, that is 0.8 kilogram. So total oxygen requirement is 3.06, but there is also oxygen present in fuel, that is 0.05, then minus this 0.05 from this total oxygen requirement, and that so total required to burn this carbon and hydrogen atom, we required 3.01 amount kilogram of oxygen. So this is the basic small little example to how to calculate the oxygen required to burn the material. And now I'm going to present a video on the combustion of fuels. I think it is Are you?
Oxygen in a chemical reaction.
Raksha, there is no sound in the video.
Hello?
No, there is no sound.
Okay. I'm audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So this is a video about a little bit combustion of the fuel. This is what we already discussed, how combustion take place and regarding the inappropriate combustion. Now come to the first classification of fuels, that is solid fuels. So there are generally we discuss two type of solid fuel, wood and charcoal. So everyone know what is wood? That is growth on the planet Earth and in different forms. Here is the classification of, this is the basic right? In spite of this classification, there are other number of type of also available of woods. First one is beech wood, birch, then boot, or you can say firewood, then pine wood. There is also peak, teak, and number of classifications or number of segments available of woods. And basic thing is this cellular tissues and lignin available. This is the basic, this is basically carbon content in the wood. And obviously water, sugar, or fat, tar is also part. But most important or most percent heavy percentage available in cellular tissue, just like human tissues. So wood also have tissues. As you all know, wood also breathe like us. Plants also breathe like us. So there must be some tissues are there. So percentage of this tissue is beech wood is 45 and 55.90 in firewood. In pine wood, it is 53.27, and lignin amount is little less than cellular, but it is also a good percentage, 39.14, 28.21, 26.91, 28.18%. And if we average it, there is 12% of water or water content, or you can say moisture is present. And obviously every woods have or plants have sugar or glucose form. So glucose form is 2.5% if we go with the average, and fat tar is 0.1 or 1%. Then moving to the towards the next, and this is in this slide here is manufactured fuel. This is the secondary fuels obtained from the this wood, coal. Charcoal is obtained from coal, and coke is also a secondary version of coal. I think there is some problem. So here is the, it's a problem due to machine is heavily loaded. My computer is heavily loaded. I use machine because I belong to mechanical field. That's why it's in our general practice, that everything in this world is machine. So here is the average value of constituents of woods. Carbon is, as I already said, that carbon is present in the 50% in the wood. And oxygen is 35%, and nitrogen available in 7%, and hydrogen percentage is 6%, and ash content is basically, you can say, drawback or consider in the disadvantage category, but directly or indirectly it is a part of fuels or wood. It is in wood 2%. Then next category is coal. This is also a part of, come in the category of solid wood. So coal is, everyone know, black or brown type material available in different, in beneath the earth. It is readily combustible black or brown, black sediment, rock, It is composed primarily of carbon along with variable quantities of other elements, chief sulfur, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. Coal, a fossil fuel, is the largest source of energy for the generation of electricity worldwide, as well as one of the largest worldwide source of carbon dioxide emissions. Coal is the, if we categorize it, then it is considered as a conventional fuel. It takes almost 300 years to produce, or you can say to convert biological material into coal. So coal is basically rocks, and there is one line here, carbon along with variable quantity. Every fuel contains carbon. Carbon means source of energy. This carbon produce one large amount of heat, means the fuel contain having large number of carbons, that means they have large number of quantity of energy in it. But it also parallelly produce, after burning it produce carbon dioxide, so carbon monoxide. So here is the coal, how the coal is prepared or comes in on this planet, on our earth. First, everything in this world decayed, vegetations or all the materials that is technically live may be dead at some point or someday. Then under high pressure and high heat, in the absence of air, it took almost 300 million, as I told two or three times till now, 300 million years, then this convert into coal. So here is the photograph, that these are the vegetables, plant or everything on this earth. Then these convert with time and high pressure or with high heat, that convert into coal according to this diagram. And there is here is the category of different type of coal available. First one is peat and lignite, and then coal. There is a classification of types of, you can say types of coal. First one is peat, lignite, sub-bituminous, bituminous, anthracites. I think all we already studied number of time in our school time, these classifications. So anthracite is one of the best category of fuel used in industrial as well as in domestic purpose. The highest carbon ranking coal carbon content is 86% to 97%. So anthracite is one of the best formation of coal inside the earth. And I have also video formation of this coal, but I think there may be some technical or network issue, or also we have time constraint. So I will post this video in group. Then moving toward the next, here is the compositions of coal, peat, lignite. These are the different percentage of carbon content, volatile. Volatile material is the extra metals like nickel, cobalt present in, or you can say these materials you used for burning purpose. Then according to this carbon percentage, as I already told, that carbon percentage is the main factor. So in anthracites, carbon percentage is 90%. And there are number of properties that we will discuss in later for biofuels point of view. The main test we use for analyze coal is, as we already studied in our schooling time, or you can say at our college time or in any chapter in physics or chemistry, there are mostly two type of test available, or we can done on this coal testing. One is proximate analysis and the second is ultimate analysis. The output of these two tests is to find the water content, ash content, moisture content, carbon particles, etc. that is we can find it that it is used for us or not. Hango. What I think is there is network problem due to this. My machine hang. Okay. Now advantage and disadvantages. Obviously pros and there are number of pros and cons of solid fuel. So there are different solids pros and cons. First one is let's discuss advantage. There are easy to transport. Obviously, it can be trucked or loaded or unloaded in different form because it is available in solids form. That's why we can easily transport it from one place to another place. Then they are convenient to store without any risk or spontaneous explosion. So there is no spontaneous or self explosion take place in solid fuels like coal. So it is convenient to store it. Their cost is obviously low. They possess moderate ignition temperature. So that is fulfill our requirement as a fuels. So and then next is disadvantage. Their ash content is high. Obviously we all know after burning they produce number of percentage of quantity of ash is very much in coal. Then their large proportion of heat is wasted. Obviously, after burning, we can direct the heating process of this coal burning. So there must be wastage of heating. So this one is a drawback. Then their combustion operations cannot be controlled easily. That's why there is number of losses of heat is more as compared to other fuels. Their cost of handling is high. Transportation costs may be low, but handling cost is high. Store. Now come to the liquid fuels. Say in the same way, the liquid fuel is also categorized into two category: natural and synthetic. Natural is primary fuel and synthetic is secondary fuels. And here is how the natural liquid fuel, or you can say crude oil and gaseous fuels available, or you can say find out inside the oceans. Actually, this is not a solid thing. This is the pictorial view of oceans, cutting pictorial view of oceans. So gas and oils are beneath, at the bottom, below the bottom of these oceans. So we can extract it with some technique or methodology. This oil and gas parallelly, combinedly, we can remove and use it accordingly to our requirement. So these oil and gas also form somewhat in the similar way, just like coal, but this oil and gas formed due to the live and or you can say plants available inside the or dead elements, dead like fish, etc., or algae inside the oceans. It also take number of years to convert these dead elements into oil and gas. There is a composition of crude oil that is carbon present in 83% to 87%, hydrogen is 11% to 14%, nitrogen is 0.0% to 0.5%, sulfur is 0% to 6%, and then oxygen is maximum up to 3.5%. Plus oxygenated compounds, like there are also other materials like phenols, fatty acids, ketones, metallic elements like vanadium, etc., also available in crude form. After that, we filter it. Here is the crude petroleum's chemistry point of view, type of structures, molecular structures available. There are the four classifications, and we categorize this crude petroleum also on this family of hydrocarbons. First one is paraffin and H2N plus 2 general formula and molecular structure is chain-like structures. Then olefin is CnH2n. This is also a chain-like structure. Then naphthane, which we use in jet fuels. Then their formula is CnH2n, but the structure is ring type. Then aromatics, benzene-like structures compound, CnH2n minus 6. So a little bit chemistry here. And on that paraffin, olefin, or naphthane aromatic compounds, it is classification of petroleum is here. Paraffins convert named as paraffinic, naphthenic, and other is asphaltic. Asphaltic are aromatics, and then fourth category is mixed compound. Paraffinic is saturated hydrocarbon, I think saturated and unsaturated type of carbon. Dr. Siddharth Jain and Dr. Gaurav Dwivedi already explained in first and second session in a deep manner on the first day lecture. Saturated hydrocarbon with general formula CnH2n plus 2, where n varies from 1 to 35. These are the available in gaseous as well as in liquid form. So this is categorized as paraffinic. Then naphthenic, saturated ring hydrocarbon having general formula already explained, cyclohexanes. Then asphaltic aromatic compounds, there is something CN. There is 6 written because N values 1 to 6. So the formula is CnH2n minus 6. And combination of this is called mixed. Crude containing all paraffinic, naphthenic, and asphaltic constituents. So mixing is, there is mixing also available. Now here is fraction distillation of crude oil, or you can say refinery, what we did in refineries. So crude oil is heating from 0 to 400 degrees Celsius and different products obtained. And here is the compositions of C1 to C5 means percentage of carbon. So we get domestic fuel, synthetic organism, petrol, diesel used in ICE engines, automobiles, and diesel obtained at 250 to 320 degree, and kerosene obtained at 150 to 250 degrees, and petrol at up to 150 degree. Then heavy oils, lubricating, paraffinics, wax, 320 to 400, and at the end, above 400 degrees, we obtain carbon having quantity above 40. Waterproofing in the form of coal, tar, and stabilized for wood and metal, solids in the form of, available in the form of solids. So how we distilled it, the name of this process, we all know that is fraction distillation. And I think chemistry persons know better than me. So here is the basic properties we generally use to find the liquid for the liquid fuels, density, viscosity, flash point, power point. Dr. M. Suresh already in the yesterday lecture discussed all these properties, and also I remember he gave the ASTM or European numbers. Actually, ASTM and European numbers are the worldwide standards to test these properties. ASTM means American Society of Testing Materials, and EN denotes to Europeans. And also we have a Indian ISI numbers, but worldwide acceptance is ASTM number and European numbers. So these are the basic categories. These basic properties we learn, we use to find out the properties for liquid petroleum in our chemistry lab. Density, viscosity is measured with the help of hydrometer. Density is measured with the hydrometers. Viscosity is measured with the Redwood viscometer, flash point, and measured with the Pinsky meter, Pinsky test apparatus, and power point have also operations. Calorific value is measured with the bomb calorimeter, and sulfur content, there is separate test for it. Carbon, sulfur content, have a different device used for measure the emissions. Then most important in liquid fuel is octane number and cetane number. Octane number is used for the petrols, and cetane number is used for the diesels, which we use in our daily life. And so let's discuss octane rating. So these are the category. N-heptane is categorized as a octane number 0, and iso-octane, here is the structure of iso-octane as shown in the PPT. So iso-octane is a 100. There are also aromatic or some other compounds or different chemical compounds that having octane rating above 100. That is used to increase the anti-knocking properties. And this is what anti-knocking is. What is this is the actually drawback, or you can say disadvantage or unnecessary point happen when petrol burns in the engine. Knocking take place. Sometimes engines produce a great noise. So this noise is knocking. So if the fuel used, or you can say petrol having high octane rating, then chances of knocking is reduced. It has been found that N-heptane knocks very badly, and hence anti-knocking value of heptane has arbitrarily been fixed as a 0. On the other hand, iso-octane was found to give very little knocking, and hence its value was mixed as 100. Also, there is one point that, for example, if a fuel having octane rating 80, that means the compound in that fuel is having iso-octane category type of material is 80%, and 20% is N-heptane type of material. And here is the significance of octane numbers. The most common way of expressing the knocking characteristics of a fuel is by octane rating. So then petrol is this is the used for categorizations of the fuels. It is a system of grading gasolines. Gasolines means petrols. It is measure of suitability of fuels for high compression engines. These 3 points overall meaning is octane rating is used to categorize the fuels. Then octane boosters such as tetraethyl lead, toluene, etc. are used to increase octane number. These are the material, if we have a fuel having less octane rating, we can add it to increase the octane rating. That's why we can reduce the knocking in the engine. Here is the different hydrocarbons and their octane number. N-octane is minus 10, and so N-heptane is categorized at 0. Diesel fuel have 15 to 25. This is one of the reason why sometimes our question asks why diesel is not used in the petrol engine. This is one of the reasons, because their octane rating is very less as compared to petrol. And next is 2-methylheptane, hexane 29, and iso-octane 100%. And benzene and toluenes, these are the aromatic compounds having octane rating more than 100. That's why these compounds are used in sometime petrol to increase the octane rating. Then cetane rating. The cetane rating mentioned for the diesel fuels. The suitability of diesel fuel is determined by cetane number of cetane's value. And cetane's value number is 0 is methyl naphthalene. Aromatic compound. This is just opposite to the octane rating. Aromatic compounds have a 0 rating, and chain structures have a hexadecane or cetanes have a denoted 100. Then there is significance. Cetane number is significantly expressed for the diesel fuel quality. It is measure of fuel ignition delay, the time period between the start of injection and start of the combustion of the fuels. Actually, these terms belongs to IC engines. For example, in petrol engine there is knocking take place, and in diesel engines there is ignition delay take place. So it control the ignition delay or decrease the ignition delay if we have a very good point value of cetane number. In a particular diesel engine, higher cetane fuel will have short ignition delay period than lower cetane fuels. Ignition delay means it ignite before the strokes. So here is advantages and disadvantages. As we all know, the basic advantage. Advantage is they possess high calorie fat value as compared to gas, as compared to solids fuel. Value per unit mass than solids fuel. They burn without dust, ash, clinker, etc. Just like their ash content is less as compared to solids fuel. Their firing is easy. They easy to transport. They can clean and use economic to handle. They required less furnace space for combustion. All these categories are based on the comparison with respect to solids fuels. Then disadvantage, the cost of the liquid fuel is relatively much higher as compared to solids. We all know the price of coals and wood is very less as compared to petrol or diesel. There is great risk of fire hazard, particular in case of highly inflammable. In case of highly inflammable and volatile, they give bad odor. For effective burning of liquid fuel, special construction burning and spraying apparatus are used. A proper device is used to burn this liquid fuel. We can't burn it in openly. So next is gaseous fuel. Here is the view of burning in gaseous, burnt in gaseous state in air or oxygen. The photograph is from domestic use, and gaseous fuel is available in the form of gas, and here is different type of gas available in. Normally, these are the natural gas, gobar gas, sewage gas, wood gas, methane, producer gas, refined. Producer gas is secondary gas. Actually, this is produced from methane or some natural gas. LPG is also secondary. You can categorize it as a secondary, but basically, this is derived from natural gas. These are the different types of gaseous fuel available in market at present. So the properties we used in gaseous, important properties, this density, calorific value are obviously important, but above that, just like as we discussed in cetane number and octane number for liquid fuel and for solid fuel, we used approximate analysis. And in the similar way for gaseous fuels, there is Woob number and flame speed. So then next general classification is there are two type of gaseous, rich gas and lean gas. If calorific value is greater than 4000 kilocalorie per Newton meter, this is not a Newton, this is neutral meter, something like that, meter cube. If the value is greater than 4000, then it is categorized as a rich gas. And if its CV value is less than 1500 kilocalorie, then it is categorized as lean gas. Then Woob index. Woob index is important parameters. Chemistry person, I think already studied it. Then now calorific value is not only satisfactory parameter to classify thermal output, depend upon Woob index. So it is the importance why we find out Woob index. Woob index equal to, this is the category, calorific value divided by under root specific gravity. This is the formula to calculate Woob index. And here is the high speeds or wave flame speeds factors. This is also a category, kind of category, high flame speeds gassing, gas having flame speed factor 32 means, flame speeds means traveling of gas after burning from one point to another point is flame speed. Then Weaver flame speeds factor is 32 to 45, then it is categorized at a high flame. In low flame, it is 30 to 25 and intermediate is 25 to 32. Then effect of Woob index and flame speeds. Woob index is basically used for the interchangeability of the gaseous. Interchangeability means, for example, we use methane somewhere as a fuel. Then if we use another gas, accept that of methane, then if it is interchange or replace the methane, that is defined by the Woob, or that is find out with the help of Woob index. Intergaseous, now intergaseous nitrogen or carbon dioxide and CO reduce flame speeds and Woob index. So this is just a, you can say, minus point of the gaseous. The gases which contain carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide or inert gases or having less flame speeds and less Woob index. Then hydrogen increase flame speeds and Woob index. Hydrogen is one of the highest flammable and high speed flame speed compound, or you can say fuel. So hydrocarbon present in the gaseous fuel is reduce flame speed, increase Woob index. So here is the natural gas. Natural gas is generally, as we all know, is methane. Natural gas that is available with the crude oil. So natural gas is a hydrocarbon, which means it is made up of compound of hydrogen and carbon. The simplest is hydrocarbon is methane. It contains one carbon and four hydrogen atom. It is lightweight with high ignition temperature and is no more dangerous than petrol. That's why compressed, this is used in practically in auto sector in the compressed forms. That is called CNG, compressed natural gas. Ignition of CO and unburned hydrocarbon is comparatively less in exhaust emission. So emission quality is better as compared to petrol. This is one of the alternate of gasoline fuels, or you can say petrol fuels. Then next version of natural gas is petroleum gas. We use domestically in our kitchen, practically in kitchen. It is mainly a mixture of propane and butanes. So carbon content, obviously we know, is more than methane in propane and butane. I think it is C3 or C4, C3 for propane and C4 for butane, used mainly as a cooking gas in domestic oven, or as well as for industrial heating in furnaces. It is highly volatile liquid. It can be easily condensed. That's why we can, this is the exact name is LPG, means liquefied petroleum gas. But basically this is obtained from petroleum product. It can be easily condensed, packed, stored and utilized, which make it an ideal energy source for a wide range of application. I think we have time constraint, so let me move fast. And here is simple biogas obtained from the methane. Biogas is the combination of a number of gases available from methane, ethane, propane, butane. So biogas is generally produced in rural areas for domestic purpose and for little bit small versions. And here is advantages and disadvantages of methane. Now alternate fuels. Alternate fuel, this is the basic requirement of alternate, why we go for a conventional fuel to alternate fuel. That is the theme of our faculty development program. That's why I mentioned here alternate fuel. So here is the requirement: reducing emission that are harmful to environment and to people earth. This is what we required. That is, emission must be less as compared to conventional fuel. Conventional fuel means basically petrol, diesel. Then second point is decreasing the dependency on mineral oils. Mineral oils gasolines, etc., oils obtained from the after fraction distillations. Then next point is safeguard the security of supply. Obviously, there is a myth, or there is number of stories, or we can find in number of research papers that in 2050, all the gasolines, fuels, petrol, diesels may be diminish or at their end. So we need alternate fuels. That's why this line is here: safeguard the security of supply. Then next point is improving the supply of affordable fuels. Continuous supply is also available, must to run our system or to run a country. So that's why improving the supply of affordable is also there. This is the basic requirements of alternate fuel. What we are looking for the alternate fuel. Then opening up additional potential for innovation and employment. Obviously, if we go for a alternate fuel, then there may be new field, and new fields mean there is opportunity for research and development, also employment for a country. And here is data obtained from in 2018 ARENA, one of the global institutes that explain every year data used energy consumption globally. So here is the data with in 2015 transport, industrial power generations use renewable energy source 4% and electricity 1%, 14%, 27% electricity, and in power generation overall electricity, so this is 24. So here is a roadmap that convert that we will moving towards the renewable energy, or you can say towards the biofuels. It is proposed that in 2050 we convert this 4% dependency into renewable to up to 58, and on electricity, because demand is also increases, so we need a electricity. It's a proposed plan. In 2050, there must be for transportation, we need a 3% electricity. And for industrial, it is required 63% renewable energy and 42% electricity. And of course, for power generation, we must improve from 24 to 85%. And according to research point of view, there is the data obtained from the Scopus Index. Everyone know who did or doing, or maybe in future do research. So here is the basic data obtained from the number of publications, year wise publication from 92 to 2019 on renewable energy. This data is basically collected for a particular alternate fuels actually. So if we say there is drastically increase from 2001, number of publication increase from almost 1K to 4K. Means there is something big going on after 2001. Like just we, for example, it's a like alarming for the women that there may be diminishing or completion of fossil fuel, and we need alternate fuel. So research, first researcher come in the field, then practically implemented for the country or worldwide. So after 2005, there is drastic increase in publications, or that means research is increased after 2001 in alternate fuels. And still, I think in 2020, the data must be above 5K. And here is the source of this data is renewable and sustainable energy review paper published in 2020. Here is the number 128, and this is the roadmap. Actually, this is the roadmap described that we generate electricity from different source. offshore wind energy, offshore ocean energy, solar energy, hydro powers. Then after consumption, spare energy. We use this spare energy to convert different biological process or biofuels or biomass to convert it into useful for the industry and transportation. This is just like a cycle. We can use this spare energy for production of another form of energy. So this data is available in this paper. Then here is a different type of alternate fuels. First one is alcohol, then next is hydrogen as a fuel, then biogas and biodiesels. In spite of that, these four, there must be solar fuels, and you all know today battery run operated cars or vehicles, battery operated two-wheeler or four-wheeler or vehicles available. But our theme is biofuels, that this is the categorized according to biofuels. So alcohol type of fuels, hydrogen, biogas, biodiesel fuels. These are the properties, but I think these are the production of ethanol. I think there is a constraint of time. So I move toward directly from my, I want to show you the my research work, actually. What I did on biodiesel. Because practical implementation of everything is important. If there is a second chance or turn, then I will explain how we conduct the research and these types of alternate fuels. So here is my simple work, simplest work actually, the biodiesel produced from the soybean oil. Soybean oil is the category of, comes in the category of first generation of fuel. And as already discussed number of times, there are three categories, first generation, second generation, and third generation. In first generation, edible oil. In second generation, non-edible oil. And in third generation, algae oil. I also have a third generation work with Dr. Siddharth Jain. Actually, we have a team, me, Siddharth Jain, and others, two, three persons. We work on this number of, we did a number of works, and we also have a publication. So, but this is my own work. Here is the setup produced, setup used, developed to produce the biodiesel. Here is the photograph of soybean oil. Soybean is available in every shop, locally available in every shop. So here is the, just looking mechanic, here is a DC motor with mechanical stirrer, if you can see. And this is condenser. And here is a flask for conversion. Then the process take place to produce or optimize this biodiesel is soybean oil, having, obviously we all know, having free fatty acids greater than 2.5. So we need a first esterification. Then esterification is done with the help of, normally done with the help of H2SO4, or you can say sulfuric acid. 20% sulfuric acid is used. Here I want to add one point. As already explained by Dr. Siddharth Jain, low temperature trans esterification. Low temperatures means the temperature is near about 50 degrees Celsius. So in the whole process, the temperature parameter is fixed. So the temperature is 50 degrees, heating in with sulfuric acid, esterification process take place, and free fatty acids decrease from below, decrease from two, I think soybean, in soybean oil, there is fatty acid percentage is almost 22%. Then decrease it from 22 to below 1.5. then transesterification process take place. We all know transesterification is the process of conversion of triglyceride into methyl ester or alcohol ester, basically. Methyl or ethyl or butyl, you can use any type of alcohol. So I use methanol and catalyst as a sodium hydroxides. Then transesterification process take place. Crude biodiesel is produced. Glycerol is removed, and methanol is recovery for recirculations. But this is a very need extra process, extra device to extract methanol from it. Then washing, and at the end we get the pure biodiesel. Box banking design, this is one of the response method, surface methodology techniques used. Box banking is basically design of expert software. Design of expert software available online for student version. I think there is 1 month subscription free. But if you are a researcher or you are a faculty, then you need to get their full version. Here is the design of how experimentation take place. Start. First, design the experiments. Then prediction or calculation of field with the transesterification, ANOVA process, development of regression. All these process take place in the software itself. Then finally, optimizations take place, and confirmation of experiment. The validation test is also must there. Here is the parameter reaction times, 30 minutes, 45 minutes, 60 minutes. This minus 1, 0, 5, these are the three levels of box banking. BBD, in short form, it is called BBD for response surface methodology. And so these are the three values. Catalyst amount is in percentage 1, 1.5, and 2. And molar ratio 6, 9, 12. Those who belong to chemistry very well knows that what is molar ratio means percentage of, it is kind of percentage of alcohol with the oil. It is a run of 17 experiment based on the BVD, and experiment pretty good output is obtained. That is maximum yield is obtained, 87.56%. And here is the prediction with the help of this soft design expert BBD software, box banking design software. Here is the 3D effect of yield produced, catalyst versus time. So from the diagram, it is clear that if the time is increased, then yield first increase, and then after a critical point, then it decreases. But in catalyst point, say if the catalyst amount increases, that is 1 to 2, then percentage of yield drastically decrease. So catalyst effect is more. Then in this diagram, it is a 3D diagram of molar ratio versus time. So both parameters first increase and then decrease. If you know the response surface methodology, so this is one of the best type of graph obtained in response surface methodology, because optimization point is this red point. We move from here to center, towards the center. So center is the output or maybe the perfect answer of our research. Then third is molar ratio versus catalyst versus yield. Then obviously catalyst, as I already explained, decreases with the increase of catalyst percentage, and molar ratio first increases and then decreases. There are number of factors. Actually, this catalyst or percentage effects may vary from feedstock to feedstock, oil to oil condition. So this is not necessary that in each and every experiment it first increases or decreases. There may be some drastically increases, or there may be some drastically decreases also. So here is the optimization's theoretic value of catalyst amount is 1.8. This theoretical optimization value is find out with the help of software design expert software. And reaction time is 34 minutes. Methanol ratio is 7.6. then biodiesel obtained is theoretically 74%, and then validation test is conducted with methanol ratio 8, which is approximately equal to 7.68. Catalyst amount is 1.8, reaction time is 34. Then predicted yield is this 78.4, but experimentally if we found that experimental yield is 80.86, and percentage error between experimental and predicted is 2.96. So there is not much difference. So it is acceptable. On the basis of this heading, optimization at low temperature transesterification biodiesel production from soybean oil methanolysis via response surface methodology. This is actually already published in SCI publication Energy Source Part A. And here is my few publications work with Dr. Siddharth Jain and other colleagues in different SCI with different impact factors. And recently, Dr. Siddharth Jain and I published a paper on Jatropha algae oil, as Dr. Siddharth Jain already explained in detail, on American Chemical Society ACS Omega having impact factor 2.8. So I think time is up, and still I have a number of things to discuss, but maybe sometime or maybe next time.